Hello, everyone. Sometimes you get a nice surprise when shopping on eBay. This IBM Model 2 keyboard from 1993 was listed as not working, so when I plugged it in and it worked flawlessly, I thought I made a great deal. But after using it about 2 times, it turned out something was awry after all, as it just stopped working. And with no amount of unplugging and replugging making any sort of difference, it's starting to be pretty clear that I either have to resell this thing or try taking it apart. So you can probably guess where this is going. Under normal working conditions, when you plug in this keyboard, you should see the 3 LEDs flash quickly and then stay off. But for this one, scroll lock and caps lock just stay on. At least if I plug it into a real PS2 socket. If I plug it into a USB socket, they do turn off eventually. In the IBM AT and PS2 technical reference manuals, this is referred to as the basic assurance test. And it just means that the keyboard controller inside the keyboard is running a self-test and returns AA hex if it succeeds on the data lines. But this keyboard doesn't. Since the keyboard LEDs are stuck, we don't even have to check if an error code is available though, as the internet seems to firmly agree that a keyboard with this symptom has bad capacitors on the controller board. And that is an easy fix, if we can get to them. I was looking around for guides on how to take the keyboard apart, and this certainly isn't the first one, not even the first video, but all the guides I did find were skipping steps. So I'll try to make sure I don't skip anything important for this one. The keyboard has 2 screws on the back, which seem to need a pretty specific driver, but I'm lucky my Swiss Army knife can opener seems to fit perfectly. It would have been great if we could just take off the back and fix the PCB, but sadly the latches to take it apart are underneath the keycaps, so I'm happy I have a keycap removal tool handy. If you haven't heard of the Model M2 before, you might have heard about the good old reliable Model M keyboard. And this is kind of the opposite of that. The M2 doesn't have a bulky metal backplate, it's not really known for its reliability. After all, we're in the middle of repairing one that just stopped working out of nowhere. And in general, it's just cheaper and lighter. And in this case, cheaper means $173 in 1993, which, adjusted for inflation, is around $374 in 2024. A modern mechanical keyboard doesn't sound that expensive now, does it? It does have the buckling springs of the Model M though, giving it that distinct clicky feel of an old mechanical keyboard. The demo will have to wait though, as I almost have this as far apart as I need to get to the likely suspects. If I grab the top cover with one hand and gently pry as I unhook the latches with a screwdriver in the other hand, it's not complicated, but of course it's hard to tell how brittle plastic is after over 30 years, so they might just snap for no particular reason. If I was smarter and better prepared, I probably would have turned the keyboard over after unhooking the latches, but instead I did this and every single one of the buckling springs are now in a big pile instead of where they were seated, and I'll have to reseat them one at a time while reassembling. I also have to be careful to skip the right holes as they aren't all supposed to have a spring. Oh well, that bridge when we get to it. Because now we can actually get to the PCB. It seems pretty stuck in there, and I've heard the tabs holding the PCB are even worse than the ones keeping the keyboard together, so I think I'll just try to do the repair without removing it. Luckily, I already have some SMD electrolytics of the right rating, but I've heard it's not a disaster to replace them with through-hole ones as there's plenty of space. There are many ways to get rid of old caps, but my favorite in this situation is simply to snip it off using my wire cutters, as that'll decrease the thermal mass and make it easy to desolder one side at a time with my iron. If I was in my garage, I might have used hot air instead. Maybe I should also take the extra time to clean away all the solder with some copper braid, but I seem to have misplaced that, so instead I'll reuse what's left on the pads, and that should do just fine, along with some fresh solder. The bigger electrolytic is supposed to be 47 microfarads rated for 50 volts, and the smaller 2.2 microfarad also rated for 50 volts. And with both of those in place, it still doesn't work. But that makes sense, because it seems I don't have a good ground connection on the 47 microfarad cap. I've noticed before that old IBM boards don't have a lot of thermal relief on their ground pads, which means you have to be extra careful not to make cold joints. And I guess in this case, I wasn't. I guess I'll learn eventually. And it also looks like I didn't actually put the small 2.2 microfarad cap I intended, but grabbed another one by mistake. So I better swap that one too. And now let's see if it works. It looks like it does. You might be wondering what this PLCC chip actually is, since you might not get a lot of results if you try to Google the markings. If you ask ChatGPT, it'll tell you it's supposed to be an Intel 8042, since that's the keyboard controller found in the AT and PS2 machines. Except that's completely wrong, since the 8042 is the controller on the motherboard, while this is clearly inside the keyboard itself. If this was the earlier Model M, this mystery would have been much easier, since that has a DIP IC with clearer markings. On the Model M, it's clearly a Motorola 6805 microprocessor unit, or what we today call a microcontroller, since both abbreviate MCU. With a little bit of fiddling about with the pinout and cross-referencing to other PS2 keyboards, it's clear that this is also a 6805 variant, hinted by the Motorola logo, but unlike the first Model M, this is now in a 44-pin PLCC. According to the keyboard enthusiasts over at DeskThority, link in the description, some of the M2 keyboards did come with markings mentioning the 6805, but only those manufactured by ST. If you're thinking you might be able to use this microcontroller for other things, you're out of luck though, as this comes with a factory-programmed mask ROM. Since I messed up earlier, now is the time to put back over 100 springs. Since not every hole needs a spring, I'm happy I have a video of the disassembly, and if I mirror where the springs were on the front, it's pretty easy to see where they go. With the springs back in their barrels, all we have to do is click the keyboard back together and make sure the latches are in the right place before we squeeze it together. When putting back the keycap, it's super important to make sure the spring is inside the keycap before pushing it down, as it's a bit too easy to squish the spring, making it lose its buckle. And you'll only be able to fix that if you're lucky, so try your best not to crush the spring. With all the keycaps back in place, I guess all that's left is to give it a quick test. Either way, thanks for watching.